I cannot remember how much did I teach for the Laplace transform in our last class, but maybe you just only need to remember this equation. The Laplace transform of a function in time domain is equal to the integral from zero to infinite of that function multiplied by e power minus st dt. And the inverse Laplace, of the function in the S domain, will be a function in time domain. It's also the integral of function in the Laplace domain multiplied by e power st and ds. I hope you still remember a unit step, no, a step function with magnitude m. A step function with magnitude m is the thing that have value shift from zero when time less than zero to the value m when time is more than the tricking point. So the Laplace transform of the step function is equal to the integral from zero to infinite of a constant multiplied by e power minus st dt. Of course, a constant m, you can bring it out from the integral, and you have the integral of e power minus st dt. E power minus st dt is equal to e power minus st and divide by minus s. And the limit of integration is from zero to infinite. So what if when t is equal to infinite? When t is equal to infinite, e power minus s multiplied by infinite is equal to 1 per e power infinite, which means zero. So when t is equal to infinite, it's gonna be minus zero. How about when t is equal to zero? E power minus s multiplied by zero is one per e power zero. It's equal to one. So if t equal to zero, it's gonna be one per s. So zero minus minus gonna be plus. So finally, the Laplace transform of step function is equal to the magnitude of that step divided by s. Laplace transform of step function is the magnitude of that step divided by s. How about the Laplace transform of lambda function? Lambda function. Lambda function means when time less than zero, the function value will be zero. When time more than zero, we have a constant slope. We have a constant slope. So the Laplace transform the Laplace transform of the lambda function is equal to the integral from 0 to infinity of at e power minus st dt. For the by part integration, integral u dv is equal to integral u dv is equal to uv subtract by integral v du. So in this case, let's set u equal to at, u equal to at, so dv gonna be no, I'm sorry, dv gonna be e power minus st dt. U, du is equal to a dt, and v is the integral of this. It's gonna be e power minus st dy by minus s. So from the bipart integral, from the bipart integral, the integral of a d a t e power minus s t d t will equal to u v. At e power minus st dy by minus s, and limit of integral from 0 to infinity, and integral v du, integral v du gonna be minus and minus, e power minus st dy by s a dt, and integral from 0 to infinity, right? Integral v du minus minus du. Okay, and let's see the first one here. When t is equal to infinite, when t is equal to infinite, e power minus st will be zero. When t is equal to zero, t is equal to zero, the numerator also equal to zero. And for the second term of the integral here, we're gonna have a divided by s, and we're gonna have e power minus st divided by minus s, and limit of integral from zero to infinity. So we have zero, and when t is equal to infinite, it's gonna be zero. When t is equal to zero, it's gonna be one divided by s squared. So in this case, the Laplace transform of the lambda function will be the magnitude of the slope, and the s will be s squared. If you see something here from the step function, we only have the divide by s. For the lambda function, with the first order of t, we see s squared. I think you can imagine, if ft is equal to a t power n, for example, do you have any idea for the Laplace transform? Before this, ut is equal to m t order zero. The Laplace transform is m divided by s. In this case, ft is equal to a with t power one. We can see s square here. So maybe if we see the function that is one constant multiplied by t power n, we may can expect to see the Laplace transform is a divided by s power n plus one. And how about the sinusoidal function? We may can begin from the Euler identity. The Euler identity said that e power j omega t should equal to cosine omega t plus j psi omega t. So e power minus j omega t should equal to cosine of minus omega t. Cosine of minus omega t is equal to cosine of omega t, right? But sine of minus omega t, gonna be minus sine omega t. So sine omega t equal to the first equation subtract by the second equation. The first equation subtract by the second equation, we're gonna have
j sine.
Let me. The first equation subtract by the second equation, we're gonna have 2j psi, right? 2j psi is equal to e power j omega t subtract by e power minus j omega t. Okay, and it means that psi omega t is equal to e power j omega t subtract by e power minus j omega t divided by 2j. Okay. You will check by yourself cos omega t. In the terms of the exponential function, what it should be, it may be the plus of 1 plus 2 and divide by 2, you will have the cosine omega t. But what should we do next when we have this? The Laplace transform is equal to the integral from 0 to infinite of the function a per 2j of e power j omega t subtract by e power minus j omega t and e power minus st dt, right? Not easy. What next? So we have a per 2j, and when we combine this two one, we're gonna have e power minus s subtract by j omega t dt. And the second term is gonna be e power minus s plus j omega t dt. And we know that the integral of the exponential is not that complicated. We only have the same one inside. And divide by minus s subtract by j omega. And the limit of integral, the second term, e power minus s plus j omega t divided by minus s plus j omega from 0 to infinite. Okay, when t is equal to infinite, when t is equal to infinite, this is gonna be 0. And when t is equal to 0, when t is equal to 0, it's gonna be 1 per minus s subtract by j omega. For here, if t is equal to infinite, again it's gonna be zero. And for t is equal to zero, it's gonna be 1 per minus s plus j omega. And I don't know, I have enough space to continue until the finalized form or not, but finally you're gonna have 1 per s subtract j omega and plus minus 1 per s plus j omega. Check by yourself if we can have this one as the final solution or not. And try to do the case of cosine omega t and check if we have this one or not. But it's almost the same at the final solution. It need to be divided by s squared plus omega squared, but for psi function, we have omega. For cosine function, we see the s here. And okay, the function with time delay, the function with time delay means, for example, if you have the function, unit step function, for your unit step function, the tricking time will be zero. But for the function with time delay, the tricking time will change. So for here, the unit step function at time zero is change the value. For the second one, if t is equal to alpha, it will be u zero. It will show the effect of the unit step when t equal to the alpha. It will show the tricking point here. The function with time delay, the Laplace transform of a function with time delay, Laplace transform of function with time delay, will equal to the integral from zero to infinite of that function. Multiply by the unit function with time delay, e power minus st dt. This one, the meaning of this. Is the value of function will be equal to zero when time is less than alpha. And the function will have value of 1 when time is more than or equal to alpha. So the function is shaped by alpha. And it also multiplied by the unit step with time delay. So the Laplace transform of the function with time delay, the Laplace transform of the function with time delay the Laplace transform of function with time delay will equal to the Laplace transform of function with time delay, and just multiply by the unit step with time delay. We're gonna set the parameter tau that equal to the time shift. So the time itself is equal to tau plus the shift, and the time derivative is equal because we only have a constant shift. So we're gonna transform this one into the function of tau when t is equal to zero. Tau is equal to minus alpha. When t is infinite, tau also infinite. The function will be written in the form of tau, and unit step also change the value to tau and have a trig point at zero instead of the alpha. And exponential function will be tau plus alpha dt is d tau. We know that the unit step with tau have the value only when tau is more than zero. This of tau, unit step of tau will be zero and one. It will be zero when tau is less than zero, and will be one when tau is more than or equal to zero. So it means that when tau is negative, the value of function will be negative, and we don't need to consider the integral at that region. So we change the limit of the integration, and we also have a constant. We have a constant. The constant will be e power minus s alpha. Alpha is a constant, and the integral will change the limit from zero to infinite, because when tau less than zero, the value of function will be zero. F tau e power minus s tau d tau. So if you're familiar with the Laplace transform, it's a function in time domain multiplied by e power minus st dt. It will be Laplace transform. In this case, the f function with time delay can be any function. The f function with time delay can be any function, any complicated function. We still don't know the form of function. But if we have the time delay, with alpha unit. The Laplace transform of function with time delay will equal to e power minus s alpha, or if you want to begin with a constant followed by the s variable, it will be alpha s and multiply by the Laplace transform of that function, Laplace transform of that function. So maybe the derivation is a little complicated to understand, but you may only remember the result, the Laplace transform of a function with time shift, Laplace transform of function with time shift will equal to e power minus time shift s and multiply by the Laplace transform of that function. We need to use this here. This function is a square. This function is a square function. A square function is composed from the first component, that is a step function, a step height a divided by t zero, a step height a divided by t zero, and have a tricking time when t equal to zero. Another function is also a step function. The magnitude also the same, but the tricking time will be at t zero. If this function subtract by this function, what's gonna happen? We're gonna trick it up when time equal to zero. And we're gonna subtract it with the same magnitude when time t equal to t zero. So we're gonna have a rectangular wave with the width from zero to t zero. So the function that have the value with this magnitude, only when t is between zero and t zero, and the outer area outside this time frame, the value of function gonna be zero, can be composed from a step function subtract by another step function with time shift. So the Laplace transform of ft The Laplace transform of ft can be formed from the linear combination of the Laplace transform of the first unit step function, not unit step, of a step function. And subtract by a Laplace transform of a step function with time shift Do you remember the Laplace transform of a step function with the magnitude a divided by t zero? A step function. We just have s as the denominator. How about the Laplace transform of a step function, but with the time delay? Of course, we still have the one of the step function, but what is the effect of the time delay? The effect of the time delay will be e power minus of the time delay multiplied by s. In this case, the time delay is t zero. So what we have here, finally the Laplace transform of this is equal to the common term, and the effect of the time delay we are going to have why in this case we define the magnitude of the step function to be something complicated, a divided by t zero. We have one reason why we define the magnitude to be a divided by t zero. In this case, the area of the square, the area of the rectangular will equal to the height multiplied by the width. In this case, the area, the shaded area, is the height multiplied by the width is equal to a. We are going to talk about the Laplace transform of impulse function. Impulse with the area A. Impulse with the area A. This gonna be impulse with the area A when the t zero is very, very small. The impulse function has the area under the curve, but the t duration of the time is very small. So if we want to have the Laplace transform of the impulse function with the area A, we need to consider the rectangular function first, but apply the limit of t zero equal to zero. When t zero is very small, the Laplace transform of a rectangular function here, when t zero is very small, it's gonna be the Laplace transform of impulse function. So impulse function means when time between 0 and t 0, we have a magnitude of the signal. The height will be a per t 0, but the width of the impulse, the width of the impulse t 0 is very close to 0. It's very small width, and the area still be the area of the impulse integral. So for impulse function, we still have the magnitude, but t0 need to be very small. And the function has the value when time is between 0 and t0. And outside this, the impulse will be 0. And the Laplace transform of the impulse function just take limit when t0 equal to 0 of this one. This one is the Laplace transform of rectangular signal. So we apply the limit of this. We have the time derivative. Apply it to the numerator and denominator and take the limit. And finally, the Laplace transform of the impulse function with area A. Power of the impulse A. The Laplace transform of this impulse will equal to A. But if the impulse has the area A equal to 1, if the impulse has the area A equal to 1, we call that function as a direct delta when A area equal to 1. Here is the idea of the impulse. The impulse function, when we take the Laplace transform for the unit impulse area A equal to 1, or we can call direct delta function unit impulse, Laplace transform will equal to 1. And another example of Laplace transform, you will check the derivation by yourself, but we will go quickly. The function multiplied by the exponential function here, Laplace transform just have this one. For the one that we change the ratio of the time, we shrink the time with the ratio alpha. The alpha will multiply to the Laplace transform. For the integral, the function with integral, we have Laplace transform divided by s, and we need to consider the initial integral when time equal to 0. We may familiar with f 0 f 0 mean the function when t equal to 0. F time 0 means d by dt of ft when t equal to 0, right? F time 0 is the second time derivative of function when time equal to zero. But minus one is integral, the first order integral or second order integral. And this one is what we have for the, if you remember, mx dot dot plus cx dot plus kx. The Laplace transform of d square xt by dt square is equal to s square of the xs subtract by s x0 and x dot zero. So yeah, here is what we familiar with. If we increase the order or decrease the order of the differentiation, we can use this relationship for the second order. For the second time derivative, we need two initial condition. For first time derivative, we need one initial condition. And when we have time t multiplied by the function, we're gonna increase if t is odd power, we have minus. If t is even power, it will be like minus multiplied by minus. And the power of the t will affect here. I still cannot remember the derivation of this, but just know that we have this. Okay, the last derivation today will be the useful tools, the convolution integral. Convolution integral of the function in time domain, F1 and F2 in time domain, will be the integral f1t convolution with f2t is equal to integral from 0 to t of f1t minus tau f2 tau d tau. And we can switch the order. We can switch the order of F1 and F2. And we have another variable tau for the integral. The time t will be just the limit of the integration. So the what we should know here is, what we should know here is function with the time shift, function with the time shift, when we multiply by the unit step with the time shift, when we multiply by the unit step with the time shift, the function will be zero when the time is less than the beginning time, right? We're gonna need this one, but come back to the convolution. Come back to the convolution. The Laplace transform of the convolution is equal to the Laplace transform integral from zero to infinite of the function and e power minus st dt. The convolution is this one. The Laplace transform have the e power minus st dt. So I'm gonna change the limit of integration. I'm gonna change the limit of integration from this knowledge. We know that when time is less than tau, this when time is less than tau, when time is less than tau, this function value gonna be zero. How can we change this to in when time is less than tau? It means when tau is more than t, right? Okay, so now we are talking about the function with the time tau, and we have one point of time t, and if we consider, it depends on, we are going to take this as a running parameter and one as a constant, or switching the order. But the value of function here will be zero when t is less than tau, or when tau is more than t. So it means that here, if we consider by the tau, the value of function, when we have this unit step with time shift, the value of function from t to infinite, the value of this function from t to infinite will be zero when tau is more than t. The value of function will be zero. So it means that although we integral until t, or we integral until infinite, if we multiply by this function, it's nothing changed, because when tau is bigger than time t, this value of function gonna be zero, and it's not gonna change the value of the integral. So we change the limit of integration, and we add this unit step function with time shift, but the value of the integral is the tau, and we still keep f2 tau and keep the d tau. And after that, we're gonna integral with dt later for the outer loop. So we define lambda as t subtract by tau we define lambda, and it means time t equal to lambda plus tau and dt and d lambda also the same when tau is a constant time, constant point of time. So for the inner loop, for the integration with tau, for the inner loop, we have F1 lambda, and of course this one is one lambda, it means one zero, it's nothing. And the t here gonna be e power minus s lambda plus tau, right? So lambda and tau, so we have the lambda first and the tau, the can we have the tau as the lambda, dt is the lambda. Wait a second. The tau here. Okay, dt is the d lambda, but d tau still be d tau. So e power minus st will be separate to lambda and tau. And dt actually is equal to the d of the lambda. And for tau itself, it should be a constant tau. S tau still be here, and don't forget d tau here, but we switch dt and d lambda to here. So yeah, it's not easy to understand, but we have the inner loop of the Laplace and the outer loop of the time tau, but this complicated derivation just want to prove that in the time domain, we have the convolution integral. In the time domain, we have a convolution integral. But in the Laplace domain, we only have the product of Laplace transform of the first function and the second function. Maybe you may can find the more clear explanation in the textbook for the derivation, but it requires a lot of imagination to consider which one is the running parameter, which one is the constant parameter. But what we need to use is we just know that in the time domain, we need the convolution, but in the Laplace domain, we can just directly multiply the transfer function. Okay, and the last example here is when we have a transfer function in terms of numerator and denominator, we can use the partial fraction expansion to separate the terms of the transfer function. we don't want to see the thing that like multiply to each other like this. We just want to separate it to the one that have only a single pole as a denominator. But the idea is we have a transfer function that may be in this form, but we can have the partial fraction expansion to have the separate transfer function in terms of the separate poles or the value of S in the denominator. And we're gonna apply the inverse Laplace to each individual terms and have the time domain function of each inverse Laplace, and the linear combination can be applied to this. But we will understand in the example, but when we see the transfer function, when we see the transfer function that have denominator and the numerator, we will have the number of zero equal to m, and number of pole equal to n. For the system dynamics, we always have the number of the pole more than the number of zero. For example, in the second order system, the simple one, we have two pole, but we don't have zero. We have two pole, we don't have zero. So let's see example. How can we obtain the response of the system with this transfer function? The idea is we have the repeat pole. We have three pole with the same value. If we plot it on the S plane, we're gonna have the pole S minus one. The first pole, the second, and the third pole at the same position, but we have three poles. So if we have three pole, we should know that this transfer function need to be divided to the first one with respect to the first pole. And with the repeated pole, we increase the power. With the third pole, we increase the power. If it's not the repeated root, if you have S plus A, S plus B, you know that we can separate it into maybe C1 divided by S plus A plus C2 divided by S plus B, right? And you have the partial fraction expansion and compare the coefficient, you can obtain the value of C1 and C2. In this case, we have the repeated root. We need to increase the power here, but we still need to find the value of B1, B2, B3. So how can we obtain the value of B1, B2, B3? If we want to make the same denominator, the first term have just only one order one. We need to multiply by the power 2 of S plus 1 square. The second term already have two order. We just multiply by S plus 1. And the last term already have the full order of the pole. So we don't need to multiply additional terms of s plus one. And the whole of this, we have the common denominator. Right? And we need to compare the coefficient of the numerator. So let me do something before that. When we need to compare the coefficient of the numerator, b1, in the parentheses, we have s squared plus 2s plus 1. The second term, we have b2, s plus 1. And we have plus b3. And we combine the common terms b1 s square plus 2b1 plus b2 s, and we have b1 plus b2 plus b3, right? Okay. And when we compare the coefficient, we have b1 equal to 1. And we have b2 equal to 0. And we have b3 1, 0, b3. We have b3 equal to 2. So finally, the transfer function, if we want to obtain the response of this, we need to apply the partial expansion to this, and we have 1 per s plus 1 plus 0 for b2 and plus 2 per s plus 1 power 3. How about the time domain function? If the input is the impulse, if the input is impulse, can we have ft from this fs? S plus one is come from, not sure if we have, but Laplace, well, the most important one, I'm not sure we have it. Maybe for this, we should have e power minus t of the unit step. Okay, so here the idea is, it seems like this multiplied by one, this multiplied by one. One is a kind of impulse, but it should be e power minus t. And multiply by one. And for this, it will be power three. I'm not sure it's gonna be, but we still need power two. 1 per s is the Laplace transform pair of the unit step when time equal to 0, right? So 1 per s plus 1 is equivalent to a unit step. Without time shift, but the s plus 1 here is related to the exponential It's related to the exponential in the time domain here. It related to the shift of the S domain constant here. So yeah, we review how can we separate the terms from the Laplace transfer function to the separate term with the separate pole, and we transform it to the time domain function like this. In this case, we have the repeated root. It's not usual. It's a kind of a little more complicated than the ordinary case. But yeah, today is too long for the introduction, and that's all for the content. Do you have any question?
Do we have MicroSville or Microsoft team for this subject? Because I haven't joined yet.
We are going to have Moodle.
All right.
I mean, the class platform gonna be in Moodle. I will add the Zoom record and the slide on Moodle, but I still haven't created.
All right.
I'm not familiar with the Microsoft team. Do you think we need to have Microsoft team? Do you request?
I don't know. I have to ask the author.
So maybe if I may prefer not to use the Microsoft team as our channel to communicate. So right. I'm still familiar with the Moodle. So you may contact me via email, or if you have my line, you can contact me via line, or you can send the message in the Moodle, but I rarely use Microsoft team.
No problem. Can I have your email again?
Okay. Can I type in the chat?
Yes, sir.
lonap.c@tula. Actually, if today you already have my slide in the first page of my slide, also have my email.
All right. Okay, ครับ. Thank you.
ครับ. So was very busy this week, and I will try to create the Moodle class by this weekend and add the today record in the Moodle also. โอเคครับ